Hi, welcome to today's virtual field trip at the New York State Museum. I'm Fiona, and with my colleague Anna, we are going to be exploring through different ways that people have been listening to music. We'll be looking at how these devices function, their history, and how they've improved through time. So if you have any questions, leave us a comment. If we aren't able to get to it today, or during our program, we'll try to get back to it later. To start today, I want to go back 200-300 years to our first device, the music box. So right now I just have the mechanism of a music box, and they were really the first way that people could bring music with them in their homes without having to attend a concert or listen or play a musical instrument themselves. So I'm just going to play a bit and then talk about how it works. So you might not be able to see it that well, but as this metal cylinder here rotates this way, there are several raised nubs. They feel kind of rough if you touch them, that as they rotate, pluck along this comb here. Now the comb has multiple teeth or prongs that when they are plucked, they make different notes. So our shortest prong up here, since it's shorter, it makes higher pitch notes, and then our longer prong at the bottom makes the lowest pitch note to make our melody. So now if a family were to have a music box as their main way to play music in the home, it would be much larger than this. Contemporary music boxes are smaller, like little trinkets. So an older one would be a larger box, maybe about the size of my stand that I'm using today. And the cylinders could be taken out and switched with other cylinders so you could play more than one song. So this one from somewhere in the 1800s even had a drawer to store extra cylinders. And then some of the earliest music boxes were actually made by watchmakers or clockmakers, and they'd be in pocket watches. So maybe about this big, you can see the comb here and then the metal cylinder. So Anna's going to show you our next music device, and I want you to look and see how the music box may have inspired our next music device.
Thank you.
So we're going to take a look at the Edison phonograph. So that's our thing right here, the Edison home phonograph. And as the name implies, it was invented by Thomas Edison in 1877. Now you probably recognize the name Thomas Edison from his other inventions, including the electric light bulb. Now, the really cool thing that he created with the phonograph was a way to record and play back a human voice for the first time. So you could replicate more than just a melody. You could have somebody singing or maybe reciting a poem or giving a speech recorded forever. So this is his phonograph, and we'll take a look inside. It's got this wood lid we'll take right off the top. Now you might have heard the term phonograph and gramophone interchangeable for these devices that include these little horns. The word phonograph refers specifically to the devices created by Thomas Edison, and gramophone is a more generic term for other versions of these wax cylinder players and includes devices that play records. So here is our wax cylinder. It kind of has like a plasticky feel to it. And if you look close, you'll see it has these lines in it, these grooves. You might kind of catch them in the light there. And those are kind of like the prongs you saw on the music boxes that Fiona showed you. So the needle will pick up different vibrations to play different sounds or words being said as it goes along the cylinder here. Now, the cylinder will sit on this silver piece, this little silver piece on top. And there's a needle in this little device called the carriage that will go across the device and as it plays. Now it has the power to be played because of a few simple machines that are all incorporated into this machine. Over here you can see this black band of leather. So this is a pulley, and if you look underneath, I'll pick it up, it's very heavy. You'll see this black leather band continues to another piece down below. So that's all connected and will turn and propel the carriage to move down the cylinder as it spins. Now it gets the energy to spin, not from any electricity, because again, this is around 1877 till around 1900, it would get its energy from a spring. So much like a wind-up toy, you would take a handle and turn it to tighten up a spring that's enclosed in this cast iron case, and the spring will get really, really tightly wound. And as it unwinds, it'll give energy to pull this leather band around and spin the wax cylinder to play the music. So let's see what that sounds like. We'll close this guy up. I'm gonna have to turn the handle back in on the side here. Now, wax cylinders generally would contain one song, or you might have a few of them if you have maybe a long speech or a teacher's lecture that you're playing back. And they can play exactly 2 minutes of music. So we get it loaded on here. And we'll hear some singing, because remember, this is the first time people in their homes could hear a recorded human voice. Now, the sound is projected using a horn. We have this huge horn here that is so large, we actually have this crane to support it. So the larger the horn is, the louder the sound will be. So this could very easily fill a large room with music. So plug it on here. Just wind it up. And hit play. So you can hear how loud that is. We'll turn this guy off. So this again would play about 2 minutes of sound, and it was very expensive. At the time, it cost about $150 to buy one of these machines, which was a price that not everyone could afford. So the innovations of the phonograph gave way to more improved ways to listen to music that were more accessible and could even give you more music to listen to without having a bunch of 2 minute songs on cylinders.
We had a question about the does the gramophone play slower as the spring winds down?
It's a good question. I haven't noticed it playing too much slower. It keeps it pretty consistent because it is only 2 minutes of sound, so they have it very well timed with how taut that spring can get. But you might have heard in the beginning it is a little gravelier as it starts up. So there are, again, it's not as perfect as it could be.
So after the phonograph, quickly came the invention of records and record players. So in 1889, records were created by Emil Berliner. And it was kind of the same idea as the wax cylinders. You would have these small grooves that would be read by a needle. But what was so great about records is their size. They may be wider than the wax cylinders, but because they're so thin, you can store more of them than you could wax cylinders in the same space. They initially started off playing about 3 minutes of music until 7 minutes, and then finally in the mid-1900s, LPs, or long-playing records, came out, which could have 20 minutes of music on one side and 20 minutes of music on the other. So this is really where albums started to become a thing, and music groups, bands, artists could release a collection of songs that people could listen to on just one piece. Now, records could come in several different sizes. I have at least three different sizes on my table today. This would impact how quickly the record would have to be played, so how quickly it would have to rotate on the record player, the RPM, rotations per minute. Could also impact how much could be recorded on it. And then they can also be different colors, which are really cool to look at, all the different colored records. We usually think of them as just black. We have some orange ones, some red ones. Some of them made now even are made with glitter. Now, what's really cool about doing this program and working in the New York State Museum in Albany is if you look at some of these records, I have one here, I hold it up. The logo is a dog looking into a gramophone horn. Now, this one is RCA Victor Company. There's also Victor Talking Machine Company and RCA Records. And all these companies, along with others, use the same logo. And if you're ever driving in Albany, you might pass something that looks really similar to this dog, Nipper. We have a statue of Nipper in downtown Albany. It's been here since 1958. He's about 28 feet high. He has his head cocked just the same way. And he's on top of a warehouse that used to hold a company that distributed RCA record products. So next time you're driving nearby, you should take a look out for Nipper. So now I can show you some of the record players that we have. Our first one is from about 1911. It's over 100 years old. And it would have been like a piece of furniture in a household if someone were to own one of these. And this was made by the Victor Talking Machine Company. So you can also see Nipper on top. Our record again. And now the Victor Talking Machine Company began making record players where you wouldn't need that huge horn hanging off the top that seems to take up so much space. They began making record players that were beautiful in wood and could act as a piece of furniture and also had internal speakers. So I'm going to open this so we can hear it a bit better. And then some more storage in the bottom. So I've put our record on. Just like with the phonograph, there's a really small needle here that you can see. I'll put my finger behind it. You can see it a bit better. And that'll be set down on our record. Again, this was before electricity was in households, so we can crank it and get it to play. Now this was 100 years ago how we would play records. So today, records are kind of having a comeback and they're playing a lot more. Ooh, I'm gonna go this way. And we have a record player that was made just about a year ago. It's a lot smaller. Speakers are so much smaller now. Move it up a bit. And it doesn't have to crank, you can plug it in. It runs with electricity. And we'll play a song on here. And this has an even smaller needle on the bottom. I can't really lift it up to show you though. And we don't have to crank it up. Perfect. So those are records. Anna's going to show you our next music device that was pretty popular alongside records for a number of years.
Thank you. Yes. So after records, in 1964, two different devices for listening to music were created, both at the same time. These were cassette tapes and 8-tracks. So here's a little picture of an ad for them. Both of these devices had these plastic cartridges that contained metallic, magnetic tape inside of them. So this tape would record the music, the notes, the voices, whatever is being recorded, and it would be spooled inside of the cartridge and played through the machine there. Now, though these were both invented at the same time or around the same time, 8-tracks became popular first. 8-tracks got their popularity because they were installed in cars. So aside from radios, these were the first devices where you could listen to music while you drove around without needing to just listen to whatever was on the radio. So that made them very popular. However, they weren't the most durable things to use. They wore out pretty easily, they broke easily, and as the name implied, they could only have 8 tracks of music on them. So that's when cassette tapes took over. Now, cassette tapes are a lot smaller than what we've seen with the records, and they could contain on this magnetic tape 90 minutes of sound,
on 443 feet of tape, all wound up into this tiny thing. Now, if you compare that to the wax cylinders we saw with the phonograph that only had 2 minutes of music, you can see what an improvement this was 100 years later. Now, we'll take a listen, see what these sound like in here. So here is our cassette player. I'll put it right in here. So, play some music a little easier. Of course, you would have to rewind it all the way back to the beginning when you wanted to listen to a song again, but you could listen to a lot more songs in one device. And like record players, they're still popularly used today, so these aren't exactly extinct at all. Soon after cassette tapes became popular, though, we had another invention called the stereo belt or the Walkman. So this was introduced in 1977 by Andreas Pavel, and this was a small device that could play one cassette at a time, and using some headphones, you could put it on your belt or in your pocket and listen to music wherever you were. Now, this sounds really familiar today because that's what many of us can do with our phones or an MP3 player. But at the time, Andreas Pavel had a very hard time selling his idea to companies because at that point, they all thought it'd be ridiculous for people to walk around in public with headphones on. So you can see how times have changed with that. Now, of course, you can listen to music almost anywhere. Now, from cassettes, an even better way to listen to music was created, and I'll hand off to Fiona to show you that.
So after cassettes were invented in the 1980s, specifically 1983 in America, compact discs came out, or CDs. Now, they're a similar shape to records, that disc shape, but they are so much smaller. And now records, I said, once you had long playing records, you could hold about 40 minutes of music so long as you used both sides. One CD and just one side of a CD could hold 80 minutes of music. So that's an incredibly long time to listen to music without having to switch anything out. You could also store them really well, just like with records. And then typically one side is going to have the music stored on it, and then the other side will have album art or something to identify what is actually recorded on the CD. So we're gonna stick it in a player. And what was such a great improvement about CDs is that you could immediately choose what track you want to listen to. You wouldn't have to rewind or fast forward and guess where a certain song is going to be. With CDs, you can pick the song that you want with the best accuracy possible. You know that you're going to get to the beginning of that song. So the CD became a really simple way to play a lot of music that you'd want to play at once, and then once people had CDs that you could record your own songs on, they really took off. So that's it for most of our devices. Anna's going to finish us off today. Thank you so much. Were there any questions about the CDs or the records?
We had one question. When did headphones come into common use?
Oh, I'm not totally sure. I'd have to look that up, and we can try to get back to you later. Because we definitely know that they're very common today, and especially after the Walkman came out. But that's something good to look up.
Thanks. So the last thing we'll look at today is something very common that we all probably have used at some point, even just before this video started.
These are MP3 and digital music. So MP3 players were introduced in 1997, and then the iPod, of course, came out in 2001. Now, these allowed music to be downloaded, so you don't see anywhere to insert any disc, any cartridge. It would just all be contained on the software inside the machine. Of course, today, with streaming, you don't even have to download a song to access anything you want to listen to or watch on your phone or your computer or tablet, wherever you are. So it's a lot easier, and there's a lot of options for how you want to listen to your music. And you can see all the different ways music has changed over time, all of the innovations that have been built upon to make music what it is today. So next time you're listening to a song on your phone or playing a video on your computer, think about all the different ways people have listened to music in their home, beginning with 1877. Thank you so much for joining us today, and thank you to everyone who generously lent us some of their devices and music players for us to play with today. Again, if you have any questions, leave them in the comments and we'll get back to them when we can. But please stay tuned for more virtual field trips from the museum. Have a great day.